Okay, the next sutta is 51.11, Asavati. The Buddha said, monks, before my enlightenment, while I was still a bodhisattva, not yet fully enlightened, it occurred to me, what now is the cause and condition for the development of the basis for psychic power? It occurred to me, here a monk develops the basis for psychic power of concentration due to desire, accompanied by effort and volition, thinking, thus my desire will be neither too slack nor too tense, and it will be neither constricted internally nor distracted externally. And he dwells perceiving after and before, as before, so after, as after, so before, as below, so above, so below, as by day, so at night, as at night, so by day. Thus with the mind that is open and enveloped, he develops the mind imbued with luminosity. Stop here for a moment. Here, all these terms, we will come across it later on page 1737, 10 pages from here. I'll go through it quickly. The desire will be neither too slack nor too tense. That means if it's too slack, that means it's no effort. If it's too tense, it's too much effort, so it becomes restless. And constricted internally means you have sloth and torpor. And distracted externally means the attention goes out to the five cores of sensual pleasure, to sight, sound, smell, taste, and touch. Perceiving after and before, that means the perception of after and before is well grasped by the monk, well attended to, well considered, well penetrated by wisdom. So probably it means as before, so after, is consistent all the time. Before his meditation and after his meditation, it's the same. And by day, as by night, at night, so as above and below, on page 1737, it says, monk reviews this very body upwards from the soles of the feet, downwards from the tips of the hair. It is in this way that a monk dwells as below, so above, as above, so below. Then, as at night, as by day, that means he makes the same effort at night as by day. He develops the basis for psychic power of concentration due to energy, accompanied by effort and volition. And similarly, he thinks, thus my energy will be neither too slack nor too tense, etc. Similarly, he develops the basis for psychic power of concentration due to mind, accompanied by effort and volition. And similarly, he cultivates the basis for psychic power of concentration due to investigation, accompanied by effort and volition. When the four bases of psychic power have been developed and cultivated in this way, a monk wields the various kinds of psychic powers. Now this one is the Pali word is idivida. I mentioned just now, psychokinesis. Having been one, he becomes many. He multiplies his body. Having been many, he becomes one. He appears and vanishes. He goes unhindered through a wall, through a rampart, through a mountain as though through space. He dives in and out of the earth as though it were water. He walks on water without sinking as though it were earth. Seated cross-legged, he travels in space like a bird. With his hand, he touches and strokes the moon and sun, so powerful and mighty. He exercises mastery with the body as far as the Brahma world. This last part means that with the body, he can fly, the flesh body, he can fly with the flesh body up to the Brahma heavens, but not further than that. The other heavens are too far. When the four bases for psychic powers have been developed and cultivated in this way, a monk with the divine ear or heavenly ear, which is purified and surpasses the human, hears both kinds of sounds, the divine and human, those that are far as well as near. When the four bases for psychic powers have been developed and cultivated in this way, a monk understands the minds of other beings and persons, having encompassed them with his own mind. He understands a mind with lust as a mind with lust, a mind without lust as a mind without lust, a mind with hatred as a mind with hatred, a mind without hatred as a mind without hatred, etc. An exalted mind as an exalted mind, a surpassable mind as surpassable, a concentrated mind as concentrated, liberated mind as liberated. So here he can read the minds of other beings. And the four bases for psychic powers have been developed and cultivated in this way. A monk recollects his manifold past abodes, that is, one birth, two births, three, four, five, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 100, 1,000, 100,000 births, many aeons of world contraction, many aeons of world expansion, many aeons of world contraction and expansion. Thus, there I was so named, of such a clan, with such an appearance, such was my food, such my experience of pleasure and pain, such was my lifespan. Passing away from there, I was reborn elsewhere. And there too I was so named, of such a clan, with such an appearance, such was my food, such my experience, etc. Thus he recollects his manifold past abodes with their modes and details. So this one is able to recollect his many, many past lives. When the four bases for psychic powers have been developed and cultivated in this way, a monk with the divine eye, which is purified and surpasses the human, sees beings passing away and being reborn, inferior and superior, beautiful and ugly, fortunate and unfortunate, and he understands how beings fare on in accordance with their karma. Thus, those beings who engage in misconduct of body, speech and mind, who revile the noble ones, held wrong view and undertook actions based on wrong view, with the breakup of the body after death, have been born in a state of misery, in a bad destination, in the netherworld, in hell. But those beings who engaged in good conduct of body, speech and mind, who did not revile the noble ones, Aryans, who held right view and undertook action based on right view, with the breakup of the body after death, have been reborn in a good destination in the heavenly world. Thus with the divine eye, which is purified and surpasses the human, he sees beings passing away and being reborn, inferior and superior, beautiful and ugly, fortunate and unfortunate, and he understands how beings fare on in accordance with their karma. And the four bases for psychic powers have been developed and cultivated in this way. A monk, by the destruction of the asavas in this very life, enters and dwells in the taintless liberation by mind, liberation by wisdom, realizing it for himself with direct knowledge. So, this sutta says, if you cultivate the basis, the four bases for psychic powers, then you can attain the five types of psychic powers, plus the destruction of the asavas, which means liberation, attainment of arahanthood. The next sutta is 51.13. Monks, if a monk gains concentration, gains one-pointedness of mind based upon desire, this is called concentration due to desire. He generates desire for the non-arising of unarisen evil and wholesome states. He makes an effort, arouses energy, applies his mind and strives. He generates desire for the abandoning of arisen evil and wholesome states. He generates desire for the arising of unarisen wholesome states. He generates desire for the maintenance of arisen wholesome states, for the non-decay, increase, expansion and fulfillment by development. He makes an effort, arouses energy, applies his mind and strives. These are called effort and volition. Thus, this concentration due to desire, accompanied by effort and volition, this is called the basis for psychic power, that of concentration due to desire accompanied by effort and volition. Similarly, among Dean's concentration, Dean's one pointedness of mind based upon energy, and this is called concentration due to energy. And similarly for concentration due to mind and concentration due to investigation. So these are the four bases of psychic powers. The next sutta is 51.14. On one occasion, the Blessed One was dwelling at Savati in the eastern park in the mansion of Nigara's mother. Now on that occasion, a number of monks who dwelt on the ground floor of the mansion were restless, puffed up, personally vain, rough-tongued, rambling in their talk, muddle-minded, without clear awareness, unconcentrated, scatterbrained, loose in their faculties. I'll stop here for a moment. Sometimes this type of description of monks, the Buddha says, these are fake monks who don't practice the spiritual path. Then the Blessed One addressed the Venerable Maha Moggallana thus, Moggallana, your brothers in the holy life, dwelling on the ground floor of the mansion of Nigara's mother, are restless, puffed up, personally vain, rough-tongued, rambling in their talk, muddle-minded, without clear comprehension or awareness, unconcentrated, scatterbrained, loose in their faculties. Go, Moggallana, stir up a sense of urgency in those monks. Yes, Venerable Sir, the Venerable Maha Moggallana replied. Then he performed a feat of psychic power such that he made the mansion of Nigara's mother shake, quake, and tremble with his toe. Then those monks, shocked and terrified, stood to one side and said, It is wonderful indeed, sir. It is amazing indeed, sir. There is no wind, and this mansion of Nigara's mother has a deep base, that means a deep foundation, and is securely planted, immobile, unshaking, yet it shook, quaked, and trembled. Stop here for a moment. So this Venerable Maha Moggallana, just by using his toe, it just pressed on the floor, and the whole of the mansion shook. I don't know how many kutis, how many rooms this mansion has. Then the Blessed One approached those monks and said to them, Why, monks, are you standing to one side, shocked and terrified? And they said, It is wonderful, Venerable Sir. It is amazing, Venerable Sir. There is no wind, and this mansion of Megara's mother has a deep base and is securely planted, immobile, unshaking. Yet it shook, it quaked, and it trembled. And the Buddha said, Monks, the monk Moggallana, desiring to stir up a sense of urgency in you, made the mansion of Megara's mother shake, quake, and tremble with his toe. What do you think, monks? By having developed and cultivated what things has the monk Moggallana become so powerful and mighty? And they said, Venerable Sir, our teachings are rooted in the Blessed One, guided by the Blessed One. Take recourse in the Blessed One. It would be good if the Blessed One would clear up the meaning of this statement. Having heard it from him, the monks will remember it. Then listen, monks. It is because he has developed and cultivated the four bases for psychic powers that the monk Moggallana has become so powerful and mighty. What for? Here, monk. The monk Moggallana has developed the basis for psychic power of concentration due to desire, accompanied by effort and volition. He has developed the basis for psychic power of concentration due to energy, concentration due to mind, concentration due to investigation, accompanied by effort and volition. Thinking, thus my investigation will be neither too slack nor too tense, will be neither constricted internally nor distracted externally, etc. Thus with a mind that is open and unenveloped, he has developed the mind imbued with luminosity. Stop here for a moment. So because of his cultivating concentration, strong concentration, the mind becomes luminous, becomes bright. And the Buddha says in the suttas, the mind becomes bright after a person has attained the fourth jhana or higher state. It is monks, because he has developed and cultivated these four bases for psychic powers, that the monk Moggallana has become so powerful and mighty. It is monks, because the monk Moggallana has developed and cultivated these four bases for psychic power, that he wields the various kinds of psychic powers. And then the Buddha mentions all the psychic powers that we went through earlier. It is because the monk Moggallana has developed and cultivated these four bases for psychic power that by the destruction of the asavas in this very life, he enters and dwells in the taintless liberation by mind, liberation by wisdom, realizing it for himself with direct knowledge. It's the end of the sutta. So sometimes the Buddha wants to stir those lazy monks. And he gets somebody with psychic power, like the Venerable Maha Moggallana, to do a feat like this. And then they get frightened, and at the same time they realize his psychic power is so great. They also want to attain those psychic powers. So then they will start to learn. The next sutta is 51.15. On one occasion, the Venerable Ananda was dwelling at Kosambi in Gosita's park. Then the Brahmin Unaba approached the Venerable Ananda and exchanged greetings with him. When they had concluded the greetings and cordial talk, he sat down to one side and said to the Venerable Ananda, "For what purpose, Master Ananda, is the holy life lived under the ascetic Gotama?" "It is for the sake of abandoning desire, Brahmin, that the holy life is lived under the Blessed One." "But Master Ananda, is there a path, is there a way for the abandoning of this desire?" "There is a path, Brahmin, there is a way for the abandoning of this desire." "But Master Ananda, what is that path, what is the way for the abandoning of this desire?" "Here, Brahmin, a monk develops the basis for psychic power of concentration due to desire accompanied by effort and volition. He develops the basis for psychic power of concentration due to energy, of concentration due to mind, of concentration due to investigation. This, Brahmin, is the path, this is the way for the abandoning of this desire." And the Brahmin said, "Such being the case, Master Ananda, the situation is interminable. Interminable, not terminable. It is impossible that one can abandon desire by means of desire itself." Let's stop here for a moment. So here this Brahmin is saying, you want to abandon desire, you develop the basis for psychic power of concentration due to desire. So you are using desire to abandon desire. So he said, this cannot be. This situation is without an end. It is not with an end. That means you use desire to abandon desire, then you still have desire, ma. So you still have a desire, how to abandon desire? Then Ananda said, "Well then, Brahmin, I will question you about this matter. Answer as you see fit. What do you think, Brahmin? Did you earlier have the desire, I will go to the path, and after you went to the path, did the corresponding desire subside?" "Yes, sir," he said. "Did you earlier arouse energy, thinking, I will go to the path, and after you went to the path, did the corresponding energy subside?" "Yes, sir." "Did you earlier make up your mind, I will go to the path, and after you went to the path, did the corresponding resolution or determination in the mind subside?" He said, "Yes, sir." "Did you earlier make an investigation, shall I go to the path, and after you went to the path, did the corresponding investigation subside?" "Yes, sir." It is exactly the same, Brahmin, with a monk who is an arahant, one whose asavas are destroyed, who has lived the holy life, done what had to be done, laid down the burden, reached his own goal, utterly destroyed the fetters of existence, and is completely liberated through final knowledge. He earlier had the desire for the attainment of arahantship, and when he attained arahantship, the corresponding desire subsided. He earlier had aroused energy for the attainment of arahantship, and when he attained arahantship, the corresponding energy subsided. He earlier had made up his mind to attain arahantship, and when he attained arahantship, the corresponding resolution or determination subsided. He earlier made an investigation for the attainment of arahantship, and when he had attained arahantship, the corresponding investigation subsided. What do you think, Brahmin? Such being the case, is the situation terminable or interminable?" And he said, "Surely, Master Gotama, such being the case, The situation is terminable, not interminable. Magnificent Master Ananda, Magnificent Master Ananda, so he took refuge in the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha, and he said, from today, let Master Ananda remember me as a lay follower who has gone for refuge for life. So you see, this member Ananda is a wise monk to explain it so well. 51.19 Monks, I will teach you spiritual power or psychic power, the basis for psychic power, the development of the basis for psychic power, and the way leading to the development for the basis for psychic power. And what, monks, is psychic power? Here, monks, a monk wields the various kinds of psychic powers. Having been one, he becomes many. He exercises mastery with the body as far as the Brahma world. This is called psychic power. And what, monks, is the basis for psychic power? It is the path and practice that leads to gaining psychic power, to obtaining psychic power. This is called the basis for psychic power. And what, monks, is the development of the basis for psychic power? Here, monks, a monk develops the basis for psychic power of concentration due to desire, accompanied by effort and volition. Similarly, he develops the basis for psychic power of concentration due to energy, concentration due to mind, concentration due to investigation, accompanied by effort and volition. This is called the development of the basis for psychic power. And what, monks, is the way leading to the development of the basis for psychic power? It is this noble eightfold path, that is, right view, right thoughts, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right recollection, and right concentration. This is called the way leading to the development of the basis for psychic power. That's the end of the sutta. So you notice here that the way leading to the development of the basis for psychic power is the Noble Eightfold Path. The Noble Eightfold Path is all-encompassing. Actually, if you cultivate the Noble Eightfold Path, you would have cultivated all the other sets in the what they call the 37 Bodhipakya Dhammas, namely the four right efforts, the four Satipatthana, four bases for psychic power, then the five Indriya, the five Bala, the seven Bhojanga. All that would be perfected when you perfect the Noble Eightfold Path. So the most important is the Noble Eightfold Path. Okay, now we come to 51.20. Monks, these four bases for psychic power, when developed and cultivated, are of great fruit and benefit. And how, monks, are the four bases for psychic power developed and cultivated so that they are of great fruit and benefit? Here, monks, a monk develops the basis for psychic power of concentration due to desire, accompanied by effort and volition, thinking, thus my desire will be neither too slack nor too tense, and it will be neither constricted internally nor distracted externally. And he dwells perceiving after and before, as before, so after, as after, so before, as below, so above, as above, so below, as by day, so at night, as at night, so by day. Thus, with the mind that is open and unenveloped, he develops the mind imbued with luminosity. He develops the basis for psychic power that possesses concentration due to energy, concentration due to mind, concentration due to investigation. And he develops the mind imbued with luminosity. And what, monks, is desire that is too slack? It is desire that is accompanied by lassitude, associated with lassitude. This is called desire that is too slack. And what, monks, is desire that is too tense? It is desire that is accompanied by restlessness, associated with restlessness. This is called desire that is too tense. And what, monks, is desire that is constricted internally? It is desire that is accompanied by sloth and torpor, associated with sloth and torpor. This is called desire that is constricted internally. And what, monks, is desire that is distracted externally? It is desire that is repeatedly distracted externally, repeatedly disturbed on account of the five causes of sensual pleasure. This is called desire that is distracted externally. And how monks, does a monk dwell perceiving after and before? As before, so after, as after, so before. Here, monks, the perception of after and before is well grasped by a monk, well attended to, well considered, well penetrated by wisdom. It is in this way, monks, that a monk dwells perceiving after and before, as before, so after, as after, so before. And how, monks, does a monk dwell as below, so above, as above, so below? Here, monks, a monk reviews this very body upwards from the soles of the feet, downwards from the tips of the hairs, enclosed in skin, as full of many kinds of impurities. There are in this body head hairs, body hairs, nails, teeth, skin, flesh, sinews, bone, marrow, kidney, heart, liver, pleura, spleen, lungs, intestine, mesentery, contents of the stomach, excrement, bile, phlegm, pus, blood, sweat, fat, tear, grease, saliva, snot, fluid of the joints, urine. It is in this way, monks, that a monk dwells as below, so above, as above, so below. And how, monks, does a monk dwell as by day, so at night, as at night, so by day? Here, monks, at night, a monk develops the basis for psychic power of concentration due to desire accompanied by effort and volition. By way of the same qualities, the same features, the same aspects, as he develops that basis for psychic power by day. Or else by day, he develops the basis for psychic power by way of the same qualities, the same features, the same aspects, as he develops that basis for psychic power at night. It is in this way, monks, that a monk dwells as by day, so at night, as at night, so by day. And how, monks, does a monk with a mind that is open and unenveloped develop the mind imbued with luminosity? Here, monks, the perception of light is well grasped by a monk. The perception of day is well resolved upon. It is in this way, monks, that a monk with a mind that is open and unenveloped develops the mind imbued with luminosity. So you see, these are the various descriptions on how to practice. Too slack is associated with lassitude. Too tense is associated with restlessness. Constricted internally is associated with sloth and torpor. Distracted externally is repeatedly disturbed on account of the five causes of sensual pleasure. After and below, the perception of after and below is well grasped by a monk. As below, so above, as above, so below, considers the body, the contents of the body. As by day, so at night, as at night, so by day. A monk practices in the same way, whether it's a daytime or nighttime. But nowadays, there are a lot of meditation teachers doesn't talk like this. It says you can sleep mindfully. And the Buddha's standard, he practices daytime and nighttime is the same. So the last part, how does he develop the mind until it's luminous? He must have attained at least the four jhanas. And attains the four jhanas, the whole body becomes bright. Or any jhana above the fourth jhana. And then in the same way, analysis of energy as a basis. And what monks is energy that is too slack. It is energy that is accompanied by lassitude, associated with lassitude. This is called energy that is too slack. And what monks is energy that is too dense. This energy that is accompanied by restlessness. So in the same way, the description is just as the previous one. Similarly for mind, concentration due to mind, concentration due to investigation. When monks, the four bases for psychic power have been developed and cultivated in this way, they are of great fruit and benefit. When monks, the four bases for psychic power have been developed and cultivated in this way, a monk wields the various kinds of psychic powers. Having been one, he becomes many. Having been many, he becomes one, etc. He exercises mastery with the body as far as the Brahma world. When monk, the four bases for psychic power have been developed and cultivated in this way, a monk, by the destruction of the asavas, in this very life, enters and dwells in the taintless liberation by mind, liberation by wisdom, realizing it for himself with direct knowledge. So that's the end of the sutta. So it's telling us how to practice the four bases for psychic powers. Most of it we know already, except this interesting part I mentioned is that if you really want to cultivate it until you get the psychic powers, then your practice in the daytime should be the same as your practice at night. Then there's a hope of getting psychic powers. 51.22 Savati. Then the Venerable Ananda approached the Blessed One, paid homage to him, sat down to one side and said, Venerable Sir, does the Blessed One recall ever having gone to the Brahma world by psychic power with a mind-made body? And the Buddha said, I recall, Ananda, having gone to the Brahma world by psychic power with a mind-made body. But Venerable Sir, does the Blessed One recall ever having gone to the Brahma world by psychic power with this body composed of the four great elements? And he said, I recall, Ananda, having gone to the Brahma world by psychic power with this body composed of the four great elements. That means with this flesh body. And Venerable Ananda said, that the Blessed One is able to go to the Brahma world by psychic power with a mind-made body, and that he recalls having gone to the Brahma world by psychic power with this body composed of the four great elements. That is wonderful and amazing, Venerable Sir, on the part of the Blessed One. And the Buddha said, the Tathagatas, Ananda, are wonderful and possess wonderful qualities. The Tathagatas are amazing and possess amazing qualities. When Ananda, the Tathagata, immerses the body in the mind and the mind in the body, and when he dwells having entered upon the blissful perception and a buoyant perception in regard to the body, on that occasion, the body of the Tathagata becomes more buoyant, malleable, wieldy and luminous. Just as an iron ball, Ananda, heated all day, becomes more buoyant, malleable, wieldy and luminous. So too, when the Tathagata immerses the body in the mind, and the mind in the body, and when he dwells having entered upon the blissful perception and a buoyant perception in regard to the body, on that occasion, the body of the Tathagata becomes more buoyant, malleable, wieldy and luminous. When Ananda, the Tathagata, immerses the body in the mind, and the mind in the body, and when he dwells having entered upon the blissful perception and a buoyant perception in regard to the body, on that occasion, the body of the Tathagata rises up without difficulty from the earth into the air. He wields the various kinds of psychic powers. Having been one, he becomes many. Having been many, he becomes one, etc. He exercises mastery with the body as far as the Brahma world. Just as Ananda, a tuft of cotton wool or kapok, being light, sustained by the wind, rises up without difficulty from the earth into the air. So too, when the Tathagata immerses the body in the mind, and the mind in the body, and when he dwells having entered upon a blissful perception and a buoyant perception in regard to the body, on that occasion, the body of the Tathagata rises up without difficulty from the earth into the air. He wields the various kinds of psychic powers. Having been one, he becomes many. Having been many, he becomes one, etc. He exercises mastery with the body as far as the Brahma world. It's the end of the sutta. So here, the Buddha is saying, actually, with his flesh body, he's able to go to the Brahma heavens. Is there anything to discuss? If there's nothing, we can stop.